maintain the GFR, but once the mesangial expansion is so marked that GFR cannot be maintained by the mechanism of hypertrophy, and then there is irreversible decline in GFR. Now, here comes the stages of DKD. So first stage is stage of hyperfiltration, their kidney damage is little and GFR gets rises, or it is more than 90 ml/min. Then it is a overt nephropathy, there the GFR starts declining and the GFR stands between 60 to 89. And keep in mind that in this latency stage or overt nephropathy, there is macroalbuminuria and blood pressure can be normal in this clinical latency or the overt clinical latency or the incipient nephropathy stage. Then when it reaches to incipient nephropathy, there is moderate decline in GFR and GFR stands between 30 to 59. In some of the literature, this stage 3 is again subdivided into 3A and 3B. 3A lies between 30 to 45 and 45 to 60 is 3B. Then grade 4, there is severe decline in GFR and it stands between 15 to 29, and this is end-stage renal disease when GFR falls below 50. So it's like up to overt nephropathy, means it's like for hyperfiltration and till the incipient, it is microalbuminuria, and from over nephropathy to renal failure, it is macroalbuminuria, that is above 300 mg/day. BP is normal up to this incipient stage, and it start increasing from the overt stage. The time duration, it is like it takes 5 to 15 years for still incipient, and 15 to 20 years for overt nephropathy or the end-stage renal disease. So that is how we can stage the diabetic kidney disease or the chronic kidney disease in that case. And we should also know the difference between diabetic kidney disease and non-diabetic kidney disease. How we differentiate between diabetic kidneys? See, there is possibility that even in patient of diabetes, kidney disease can occur due to some non-diabetic cause. So we have to means we should differentiate between a non-DKD and DKD. So how we differentiate it? So in case of DKD, the proteinuria, it is generally gradual, whereas if it is non-DKD, the proteinuria can be rapid. So gradual progress suggests diabetic kidney disease, and rapid progress suggests non-DKD cases. Then for DKD to happen, it should be long-standing diabetes, that is diabetes more than 10 years, and for non-DKD, it can be less than 5 years. And a urine analysis can help us for the diagnosis. There can be active segments like hematuria or some cast may be present in non-DKD patients, whereas in DKD, the bland sediments are present. There is no hematuria most of the time. In the late stages, it can occur definitely, but initially there is no active segment. There are bland sediments which are present. And the most classical feature for DKD is retinopathy is present in case of DKD. In case of non-DKD, it can be absent. That is, retinopathy can be absent. So this way we can differentiate between non-DKD and DKD patients. So here again, I have mentioned the stages and the functional and structural changes. I have already told about all this hyperfiltration. There can be normal albuminuria and GFR is hyperfiltrating kidneys. In silent, it is glomerular basement membrane thickening, and there is focal sclerosis, and it can be normal albuminuria, GFR can be normal. Incipient stage, there is glomerular basement membrane thickening, and there can be variable mesangial sclerosis. Then it starts with albuminuria and GFR starts declining, At overt, there is microalbuminuria, GFR decrease, blood pressure starts rising, and end-stage renal disease, there is proteinuria, decline GFR, and hypertension, and there is global glomerulosclerosis. So these are the structural and functional changes which happens in various stages of the kidney disease. Now, when it comes to the symptoms of DKD, generally early stages patient may not notice any symptoms, and that is the reason why the disease always remain unnoticed. In only stage 4 and 5, they may feel certain symptoms like swollen ankles, that is edema, in the feet, lower legs. There can be darker urine, there can be shortness of breath. Fatigue is also one of the major symptoms. Nausea, vomiting is a very late feature of kidney disease. When there is uremia or the creatinine goes very high, there can be metallic taste or in mouth. So only symptom which we generally come across in clinical practice is the edema, and sometimes shortness of breath, and fatigue more or less it is present. Now, when we come to the management of DKD according to modern medicine, improved glycemic control is one of the things which we should think about. Then use of antihypertensive drugs and a dietary protein restriction. So here, just to give a brief about it, it's like improved glycemic control, we have to monitor HbA1c levels, and it is seen that it appears sensible to optimize the HbA1c level aggressively in the early stage of the disease with no advancement in the target organ damage. And once there is like target organ damage, that time we cannot like demand for the exaggerated control, because the risk of hypoglycemia can cause the irreversible damage to the end organ. So in that case, we have to maintain the HbA1c level between around 8 gram percent. Because if we try to lower down the HbA1c to 6.5 or 7, there is high mortality rate in that case, because with that increasing hypoglycemic episodes, the damage to the end organs is more, and there is higher mortality is observed in the various studies which have been conducted to define the definite target for the HbA1c. So it's like initially it is very judicial to control the HbA1c at a strict level, that is between 6.5 to 7. But once there is advancement in the target organ damage, that time we have to target the higher HbA1c levels. That means we have to target around 8 milligram percent of HbA1c rather than trying to achieve 6.5 or 7. So now when we come to the use of oral hypoglycemic agents according to modern sciences, there are n number of oral hypoglycemic agents. Use of oral hypoglycemic agents in patients with DKD itself is a huge topic and beyond the scope of this lecture. But still, I would like to mention the few of the details about it. It's like, see, means once the diabetes is there and patient has been diagnosed with the diabetic kidney disease, we have to keep a glycemic control. So drug of choice there, I mean, finding a good drug is a definite challenge for the management. So first and foremost drug which we use for the diabetes in obese person is a metformin. And it is found that metformin can be safely used in a patient till the creatinine is less than 1.5 milligram per liter. So these are the recent guidelines of the American Diabetological Association and Kidney Foundation, that we can safely use metformin if the serum creatinine level is below 1.5 milligram. Once it goes beyond 1.5, then we have to think about the risk over benefits. We have to be judicious with the use of metformin. And it is said that if the GFR is above 60, then we can use metformin safely. But if it is reducing, then for the GFR between 30 to 44, we have to use the half dose and we have to add the other OHA. And between 44 to 59 also, we can use the same dose. Below thermis, it's between 30 to 44, we have to reduce. 44 to 59, we can use in same dose. And once the GFR goes below 30, we have to stop using metformin. Then the safest drug which we can use is sulfonylureas. We can use glycolazide in that case, because glycolazide is the only sulfonylurea which is safe for kidneys, and as well as it is safe in cardiac involvement. So glycolazide can be preferred, and then even in that case glimepiride is also preferred. Glipizide is also used safely. Even there has been studies regarding pioglitazone. So pioglitazone up to 15 milligram we can use, and we have to stop using it below 45 milligram per dl of EGFR. So it's like we have to start with metformin, and if we have to reduce the dose of metformin, and if we need to add another oral hypoglycemic, first we should add glycolazide or glimepiride or glipizide. With that also, if the sugar levels are not getting controlled, then we can add on pioglitazone. If with that also sugars are not well controlled, then we should think about SGLT2 inhibitors, that is canagliflozin and dapagliflozin. And if with that also the sugar are not getting controlled, then we have to go for GLP-1 receptor agonist, that is alibiglutide, exenatide and liraglutide. So it is like that we can choose wisely the oral hypoglycemic agents. Even DPP-4 inhibitors are used safely in kidney disorders, but only thing with DPP-4 inhibitors are they are little GI intolerant, and sometimes they can cause allergic rhinitis and like stomach upset. So we have to be careful when we are choosing for DPP-4 inhibitors like sitagliptin and vidagliptin. So wisely, what I would like to give you a take home message is, first and foremost, we have to rely on metformin. If we find 1.5 milligram of creatinine, then we have to stop metformin. If EGFR is between 44 to 59, we should reduce the dose of metformin, and then we should add either glycolazide or glipizide or glimepiride. Then we should add on next is pioglitazone. Then next we should add on SGLT2 inhibitors. Then we can think about GLP-1 agonist, and then we can think about DPP-4 inhibitors. Then second comes the antihypertensive drugs. So the best drug or the drug of choice for the diabetic kidney disease, they are AC inhibitors or ARB blockers. So AC inhibitors, they are preferred because along with controlling the systemic hypertension, they also reduce the intraglomerular hypertension. So enalapril or lisinopril. So these AC inhibitors are the main drug of choice when we are considering antihypertensive in the management. So when we are using AC inhibitors or ARB blockers, we have to monitor the potassium levels. And if the potassium we are finding like hypokalemia or hyperkalemia, then we have to think about adding diuretics. And once again we add diuretic, we have to closely monitor the electrolyte levels. So that is how the antihypertensive drugs are judiciously used for the management of DKD. The most used drug are ACE inhibitors, ARB blockers, and then add on with the antidiuretics. And the third management approach according to modern is dietary protein restriction. And it is recommended that if protein should be restricted up to 4 to 5 grams per day, we have to restrict. And even sodium intake, salt intake we should reduce, and salt intakes we have to reduce it up to 2 grams per day. Then now we will come to the Ayurvedic approach of diabetic kidney disease. So as we know, the in Ayurvedic classics, Prameh is labeled under or mentioned under Ashtamahagad. Ashtamahagad are the comprisation of 8 diseases which has got major inflicts on the health. And they are the disease which involves all the 3 doshas and saptadhatus. So while describing Prameha in Nidan Stan, Acharya Charak has mentioned this shloka that mutratvena parinamayati mutravahanam cha sotasam vangshan vasti prabhavanam medaha kleta upahitani guruni mukhani asadhya pratirudhyate tataha Prameha tesham stairyam asadhyatam va janayati prakruti vikruti bhutatva. This means when the pathogenesis of Prameha reaches up to the mutravaha srotas and its mool, that is vangshan and vasti, mukha of that srotas get upahit or pratirudhya by med and kleda. And once this mukha of this mutravaha srotas get pratirudhya by this med and kleda, Prameha leads to its stairyata and then it becomes asadhya. So here we can say that when the pathology of diabetes leads to the urinary system and when it affects the moola of mutravaha srotas, that is vangshan and vasti, then disease gets into its incurable form, which we can correlate with diabetic kidney disease according to the modern sciences. So to narrate the samprapti of the disease, here it's like once a patient is having long-standing prameha, then it is known to us that sarva eva prameha kalena pratikarinaha madumeha kadnis, all type of prameha, when they are not treated, all ill-treated, they get transformed into the madumeha. And when they get transformed into the state of madumeha, and still if they are consuming kapavardhak, medha pratikar ahar, avyayam, chinta, here I would like to mention the shloka of the benefits of vyayam. Laghavam karma samarthyam diptagnihi medha sakshayam vibhakta ganagatratvam vyayamat upajayate. So medasaha kshay is carried out by the vyayam. So if there is no exercise, then there is medha vruddhi, or there is sanchay of medha in the body. And if that nidan sevan is still persistent, if there is avyayam, ati chinta, then all that leads to kapha and medha dushti. And this kapha and medha dushti, they are Prithvi and Jala Mahabhut Pradhan Doshas. So this Kapha and Medha Drushti will lead to excessive Kleda Utpatti, or there will be excess of Kleda formation. And as we all know, the job of Mutra is to carry away all the Kleda out of the body. Mutrasya Kleda Vahanam. So whenever there is excess of Kleda in the body, there is excessive urination, because urine has to carry that excess of kleda out of the body. And in that stage also, if there is prajnapara and hetu sevan, then it will lead to medovaha srotodushti. And this medovaha srotodushti, medovaha nam srotasam dukkha moolam. So when there is medovaha srotodushti, there is vrukka dushti. And as we know, when we consider the organogenesis, the vrukha is said to be made up of from finest part of kapha and medha. Kapha medha prasadat vrukha is the organogenesis of vrukha. So vrukha is formed by the finest form of kapha and medha. So whenever there is kapha and medha dushti, the vrukha will get affected and there will be vrukha dushti. And when there is vrukha dushti, what is the job of kleda shaithilyam apadayati? So here we can say whatever shaithilya is in terms of messenger expansion and basement membrane thickening that we can correlate with this shaithilya, which can be caused due to this kleda. And as we know, medasaha sneham adaya sira sayutvam apnuyat. So whenever there is shaithilya, it will lead to sira shaithilya. Because medasa sneham adaya sira snayutvam apnuyat. So this sira shaithilya can be correlated with glomerular hypertrophy, which is an initial stage. And all this will lead to end stage renal disease or samprapti of Rukka Rog according to Ayurvedic terminology. So that was the basic basic insight for the Ayurvedic samprapti of diabetic kidney disease. To summarize, the doshas will be tridosh with vata predominance. It's like in prameha, though the initial dosh is kapha dosh, in the latter stage of complication, there is always vata predominance. Then the dushya will be medha, asra, ambu, vasa, lasika. Dushti hetu will be again agni, mandya, utpavstan, it is pakvashaya, adhishtan, it is rukva. And srotas which are involved in diabetic kidney disease are medhobal srotas and mutravar srotas. And sroto dushti will be in terms of sangha and vimarga gaman. So when we have to think about the management part of the diabetic kidney disease, we have to identify the nature of the disease in terms of dosha, dushya and adhishtan. We also have to find out the derangement of three doshas, and we see that there is predominance of vata dosha along with the three other doshas. Then Shroto Dushti will be in terms of Agni Mandya, Shroto Sangha, that is obstructions in micro channels of Mitrava Srotas, and there will be Vimarga Gaman. And so we have to break this pathogenesis if we need to have a good results in management of the diabetic kidney disease. So what will be the treatment principles, or what is the on what lines we have to treat? We have to do the Agni Pradipan, Dosha Shaman, Lekhan, Sroto Shodhan, Mutra and Rasayan. So how we can achieve that? So there are various ways to achieve it. We can use Ekal Dravya, we can use Kashay, Bati, Rasayan, Shurna and Naimitik Rasayan. So Prapunarnava, Gokshur, Varun, Kantakari, Palash Pushpa, Musta, Shilajitu, Trimunga Basma. These are the ekal dravyas which we use in this treatment. Then kashayam, punarnavadi kashay, varunadi kashay, trinapanchamul kashay, vetarvadi kashay, ghatyadi kashay, dashmul kashay and mustadi kashay. Vati, we have punarnavadi gukul and gokshuradi gukul. So when when we say punarnavadi gukul and gokshuradi gukul, both of these are diuretic according to Ayurveda. So when we have to use Punarnava and when we have to use Gokshur, so there are different theories for this. So to my understanding, Punarnava is a drug of choice when there is Vyana Vikriti or some pathology which is related to Vyan Vayu or also with the heart, then we have to consider Punarnava. And when the pathology is confining to the lower part of the body or to the apan kshetra or pati kshetra or some diseases related to renal, then we have to go for gokshuradi gukul. So it's like for vyana vikruti, we have to choose punarnava. For apan vikruti, we have to mainly go for gokshuradi. So why in diabetic kidney disease I have mentioned both? Because we, due to kidney disorders, there is along with the kidney, there is coexistence of the cardiovascular events in case of diabetic kidney disease. So we prefer both the gugus in this case. Means we can either use Punarnavadi gugul or Gokshuradi gugul. And then Arogyavardhini, which we use in view of clearing all the Soto Sangha, or we have it used for like opening up of the channels in the systems. It acts as a lekhan dravya एंड इट हेल्प्स टू लाइक क्लियर द श्रोतो संग श्रोतो अवरोध एंड देन वी कैन गो फॉर चंद्रप्रभा भट्टी एंड एज वी नो रसायन चूर्ण इज ऑल्सो यूज जुडिशियसली इन केस ऑफ डायबिटिक किडनी डिजीज बिकॉज वंस द चैनल्स आर क्लियर वी हैव टू नरिश द ऑर्गन एंड फॉर नरिशमेंट वी नीड द रसायन सो रसायन चूर्ण कंसिस्ट ऑफ गोपशू रामलकी एंड गुरुची दे आर मिक्स विथ इक्वल क्वांटिटी एंड इट इज गिवन इन अ डोज ऑफ 3 ग्राम ट्वाइस अ डे एंड इन आयुर्वेदिक क्लासिक्स शिलाजीत पुनर्नवा गोकुल मंडूर एंड त्रिफला द कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ दिस ड्रग्स आर कॉल्ड एज नैमित्तिक रसायन द्रव्य फॉर प्रमेह शोथ एंड रीनल डिसऑर्डर सो नाउ आई ट्राई टू एक्सप्लेन फ्यू ऑफ द योगा सो पुनर्नवादी योग इट इज मेन्शन इन गद निग्रह इन श्रोतरोग अधिकार इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ पुनर्नवा शुंडी त्रिवृत्त गुडुची श्यामा हरितकी देवदारु पल्प एंड इट इज एडमिनिस्टर्ड अलॉन्ग विथ माहिष्मूत्र दैट इज यूरिन ऑफ द बफेलो और इट कैन बी यूज विथ जलम देन दिस इज वन ऑफ द अनुभूत पुनर्नवादी योग ऑन विच ट्रायल हैज बीन कंडक्टेड बाय द रिसर्चर एंड इट कंटेन्स पुनर्नवा वरुण गोपशू शिक्रु पुष कांडेक्षु गुडुची शतावरी एंड शिलाजीत एंड हाउ इट इज प्रिपेर द इंग्रेडियंट्स लाइक पुनर्नवा वरुण गोपशू शिक्रु पुष एंड कांडेक्षु द फर्स्ट 6 इंग्रेडियंट्स देयर क्वाथा इज प्रिपेर देन इट इज फिल्टर्ड एंड आफ्टर फिल्ट्रेशन शिलाजीत इज एडेड टू इट एंड देन द मिक्सचर इज बॉइल्ड इन वॉटर वो बाथ टिल द सेमी सॉलिड स्टेज इज अचीव एंड देन द रिमेनिंग टू इंग्रेडियंट दैट इज गुडुची एंड शतावरी That guduchi and shatavari is added and it is mixed well and the tablets are made out of it and those tablets are used for the management of the disease. And how this punarnavadi compound acts? It possesses pitta shamak paras, tridosh har gud, tridosh har virya, pitta shamak vipak. So this combination makes it potent tridosh har mainly targeting pitta dosh. Tiktaras present in Punarnavadi compound brings about niramta and increases the jatharagni. Another useful function recommended in renal failure where agni mandi is invariably present. So tiktaras and rukshagun help in digestion of ama and clearing out the sotasas. And then tiktaras is also chosen in vadis which are involving rakta dhatu and here in renal failure, rakta is the earliest dusha which is affected. So here they have targeted pitta doshas because initially we have to clear the agni mandya. So this yoga or this kalpa mainly helps us for the soto shodhan purpose or to relieve the agni mandya. Then comes the त्रिनपंचमूल और यूज ऑफ त्रिनपंचमूल कषाय और त्रिनपंचमूल स्वरस सो त्रिनपंचमूल क्वाथ इज ऑल्सो यूज इट इज वात पित्त शामक इट इज डायूरेटिक इट इज किडनी स्टिम्युलेंट एंड इट हैज गॉट हीमोपोएटिक प्रॉपर्टीज एज वी ऑल नो इन क्रोनिक किडनी डिजीज किडनी बींग अ हेमोपोएटिक ऑर्गन देर इज एनीमिया इन क्रोनिक किडनी डिजीज सो त्रिनपंचमूल ऑल्सो हेल्प्स टू रिलीव दैट एनीमिया which is associated with chronic kidney disease and the ingredients of this Trinapanchamool are mentioned in Mutra Virechini Dashamani in Ayurvedic classics. So this Trinapanchamool is useful in treatment of asthma, anemia and it has got diuretic property. In vitro studies indicate the free radical scavenging activity, therefore it has got antioxidant potential. So therefore the disease where the free radicals are produced, this Trinapanchamool happens to be an effective remedy for the treatment of the disease. Then Varunadi Kashay, so Varunadi Kashay is also one of the Varunadi Kashay is also one of the useful drug which is used in case of management of diabetic kidney disease. So there are two types of varunadikashaya. One is Brihat varunadikashaya and one is varunadikashaya. I have mentioned here the ingredient, and both varunadikashaya and Brihat varunadikashaya, they are best diuretic and they also possess a vasodilating action. So whenever there is peripheral edema, we prefer this varunadikashaya. The main content of varunadikashaya is varun, bilva, apamarga, chitra, arni, that is agni mantra, shikru, bruhati, kiratikta, and it is given 10 gram 2 times a day. Then comes the Veertarvadi Gan Kashaya. Veertarvadi Gan Kashaya is mentioned in Sushrut Sahita 38, Shlok number 13 for Mutra Vikaras. And here I have mentioned all the details about Veertarvadi Kashaya. So we won't go into the details of each of the ingredients like Sahachar, Agni Mantra, Murva, Appamarga, Shonak, Mandu, Parmeet, they have Ushna Virya. Then Arjun, Garbha, Gokshu, they have Shita Virya. So this is in all the basic mode of action of Veertarvadi Gan Kashaya. It is used in Mutra Rogas effectively by the practitioner. So this is the drug of choice for a chronic renal failure or any type of renal disorder. It also contains Pashan Veda. So it is a remedy for the urinary stone or the calculi. So Veertarvadi Kashaya is effectively used for various kidney disorders. Then Brihatyadi Kashaya, this is my trial drug for the PhD research. So it actually Brihatyadi Gan is mentioned in Sutrasthan 38, and in Sahasra Yoga this Brihatyadi Gan is fortified with Gokshu, and that is named by the Kalpa Brihatyadi Kashaya. Contents of Brihatyadi Gan are Brihati, Kantakari, Yashti, Madhu, Patha and Indraya. And I have done the animal study of it, and I have got very miraculous result in the animal trial. Even in case of human trial with this drug, there have been it has been found very efficacious in the management of diabetic kidney disease up to grade 3. I haven't tried it on grade 4 or grade 5, but my research was pertaining to grade 3, and I could find out a dramatic result with this Brihatyadi Kashaya in case of diabetic kidney disease. Then, as I've told, Gokshuradi Gurukul is one of the drug of choice for the diabetic kidney disease. It helps to detoxify and support the healthy urinary system. It tones the kidneys. It acts on the urethra, and it is a rasayan for Mutrava Srotas. And it also has got scraping action because of Gurukul present in it. These are the features. It is anti-lithiatic, anti-inflammatory, anti-gout, anti-arthritic, it is muscle, and most important is it is adaptogenic in its nature, and this adaptogenic property helps to combat with the stress or the oxidative stress which happens in body due to chronic disorders. These are the benefits of Gokshuradi Gurukul. Chandra Prabhavati is also one of the wonder drug for the management of kidney disorders. It is potent anti-inflammatory, it is deepan, it is rakta prasadan, it is pachan, it is amadoshar, it is lekhanya, and it is medogna. So it is used on the various urinary tract diseases, kidney disorders, thyroid, bone and joint diseases. It possesses regenerator, balya, pushya. These are all the properties of Chandra Prabhavati. It prevents, and there has been studies which have shown that Chandra Prabhavati prevents glycosuria or the proteinuria. Also, it has been found that it also normalizes the blood pressure and it reduces the stress and fatigue. So, as I have told, in diabetic kidney disease, the main pathological event is the inflammation, mesangial expansion, basement membrane thickening, and oxidative stress. So being it acts on the blood pressure, being it acts on stress, it has got rasayan property. This remains the best drug for the treatment of diabetic kidney disease or chronic kidney disease. here it's like the word itself, Chandra means moon and Prabha means flow. So whenever we use this kalpa, it promotes the strength and immunity and gives flows to the body. Therefore, it is named Chandra Prabhavati. Then according to the Ayurvedic principle of management of the tissue, tissue damage can be prevented and repaired by rasayan drugs because they have the capability to improve the qualities of tissue and hence increase the resistance of the tissues. So blockage has to be removed first by lekhaniya dravyas, by scraping effect of the block channels, and then we have to administer the rasayan. So in that case, we prefer Pipali Muladi Paniyam. Pipali Muladi Paniyam is mentioned in Gada Nigraha Shotadhikar. It contains Pimpli Mool, Devdaru, Chitrak and Shunthi. And it is added along with Guruchi and Bringaraj. And 80 ml of this Paniya is given twice a day. It has got Deepan, Pachan, Shotahar and Vasti Shotak property. It is also Papahari in nature. So it helps to remove the obstruction and glomerulus and also the peripheral circulatory vessels. And thus by cleansing and activating the microcirculatory channels, circulation and tissue perfusion will be increased and it provides sufficient nutrition to the tissues when Rasayan is administered after giving this Pipli Muladi Paniyam. So which rasayan which we preferred is Shilajit. Shilajit is a time-tested drug and it is very useful in renal disorder. It has got antioxidant property. It has got complement fixing activity. And the active principle of Shilajit is fulvic acid. And fulvic acid is found to be increased superoxide dismutase activity. This is the antioxidant effect of the Shilajit. And experimental studies show that fulvic acid diminishes the development and progression of diabetes and assists in the treatment. Then in Vaishya Ratnavali, Sarvato Bhadra Ras is mentioned. And this is also one of the rasayan which is used in chronic kidney disease. It contains Swarna Bhasma, Rajat Bhasma, Abrak, Loha, Shilajit, Gandhak, Swarna Makshi. And the uses of it is in nephritis, nephrotic syndrome, polycystic kidneys, end-stage renal disease, nephrogenic diabetes, and urinary tract infection. It is given in a dose of 125 milligrams once or twice a day before or after any we can prefer. If patient is having hyperacidity, we should use it afterwards. Or if patient don't have any stomach upset, we can give it before food and we can give it up to a month. Then other rasayan yogas are Makar Dhvaj and Maheshwar Vati. Maheshwar Vati is again mentioned in Vaishya Ratnavali. In Dukkha Rog Adhikar, Makar Dhvaj, it's like it is an aphrodisiac agent according to Ayurveda, and as we know, it helps in Apan Karya Kshetra, or it is said to be like Balya for bulbous muscles or the cavernous muscle. So maybe this can also boost the kidney function. With that thought, it has been used by the practitioner as a rasayan in case of chronic kidney diseases. Then Shiva Gutika is one of the classical remedy in chronic diseases. So it's like in that Shuddha Shilajit is processed with Tripala, Dashmul, Guruji, Vala, Pato, Yashtimadu, Gomutra, Godugdha, and there is Prakshep of Karkat Shingi, Marich, Vidarikanda, Talispatra, Sita, Dalchini, Tejpatra, Ela and Nakeshar. And it is considered as a supreme rasayan. It's like whenever we can't understand anything and patient is in terminal stage or in any chronic disease, we can blindly use Shiva Gutika. It can be used in multiple disorders like liver, Rajakshma, Prameha, Medoro, Kushta, Shvitra and all type of chronic condition, we can use Shiva Gutika. Then again, a Trivanga Bhasma is best, Kledagna Dravyam. Therefore, considering clay, we can use Trivanga Bhasma to reduce albuminuria, glycosuria, urinary incontinence. And if there is frequent urination or urinary incontinence, we can go for Trivanga Bhasma. It contains Vanga, Nag, and Jashar. This three ingredients are taken in equal quantity and they are processed in aloe vera juice and turmeric, and they are then the Trivanga Bhasma is formed. It is given in a dose of 65 milligram to 250. Maximum we can give 500, and it has to be given after food, and it is generally advocated with Godum Jal lukewarm water. So when I have mentioned all these rasayan dravyas like Trivanga or Makar Dhvaj or the Sarvatobhadra Ras or Maheshwarvati, we can see there are lot of metals in that. So how we can justify the use of metals in kidney disorders? So there is one concept of hormesis. Hormesis is a terminology which is used in toxicology. And it is a dose response phenomena which is characterized by a low dose stimulation and high dose inhibition resulting into a J-shaped dose response. So it is said that in hormetic zone, there is gradual or a favorable biological response to low exposure to toxins and other stressors. So what we achieve is when we use the metal compound, those metal compounds are in such a low dose or they are in such a low dose exposure that they generate the favorable biological response and they do not affect the body, and that is a concept of hormesis. So we can justify our use of metals in case of kidney disorders. One more thing is there that we say that whatever metals we use, we purify them with all the methods which are mentioned in classics, and as we purify them, they don't get deposited or they don't harm kidneys. That is also one of the theory. But hormesis, which is one of the terms in toxicology, in that the toxic substance or the metals are used in such a low dose that they generate a favorable biological response rather than causing any harm to the body. So this way we can justify the use of metals in kidney disorder. Then, as I've told, we also give rasayan chikitsa in chronic diabetic kidney disease, and for that we use Punarnava, Guruchi, Gokshur, Shatavari and Shitajit as a naimittik rasayan dravya. Punarnava Mandur, Guruchi and Vaishwana Churna, this triple combination, that is Punarnava Mandur, Guruchi and Vaishwana Churna, this also has been tried by the researcher in diabetic kidney disease. As you know, Punarnava Mandur is a diuretic and it also helps to combat with the iron deficiency. Then Guruchi is Tikta Rasatmak, Rakta Prasadan and Rasayan, and Vaishwana Churna is again a Dhatvagni Mandya, relieves the Dhatvagni Mandya. So this triple combination is also been tried by the researcher in management of diabetic kidney disease. But of course, along with this yoke, they have advocated Gokshuradi Gokul and Shilajit. Then these are the marketed formulations. Neri KFT is one of the marketed formulation by the Emil Pharma, and it has shown very good results in like chronic kidney diseases. Then Uricare by Himalaya and Nephrosol by Vemedim Corporation. These are the drugs which are in market for treating the kidney disorders. And as we are treating diabetic kidney disease, Ayurvedic management for diabetes, we can use Nisha Katak Adi Kashay or Katak Khadir Adi Kashay. We can use Trifala and Musta. We can use Dhatri Nisha Yog, that is Haridra and Amarti Churna. Then when it comes to Panchakarma, there is unique use of Vacheri Basti. Actually, Vacheri is prepared from the goat intestine. The concept of using this Vacheri is samanit sarvada sarva bhavanam samanyam buddhi karanam. So it's like a concept of simile, means same thing which is used in the treatment. If the dusha is it's like according to Ayurveda, mutra is formed in the pakvashay. So if we use the intestine of a goat, then that enhances the mutra nirmiti by our body. That is the concept behind using Vacheri. So how we prepare vajari, basically we get a goat intestine, we make it into pieces, we get 100 gram of it, and then we add 500 to 800 ml of water, and then we reduce it to 100 ml, and we add 1 to 2 gram of sandal to it. Actually, this is the Anubhut or Buddha Vaidya Parampara Kalpa. It has been mentioned in textbook of Yogo Joshi sir. He has mentioned it for the oral use, but nowadays it is preferred by the route of Basti, and we have been trying this yoga in our institute for chronic renal failure patients, and we really have found dramatic results with this Vajeri Basti. So this Vajeri Basti is administered in a dose of 100 ml per day for 8 to 11 days. We can advocate Matra Basti in between if we want, and it is generally given in a Niruha Kal for the better absorption. Then also Punanavadi Kshir Basti has been mentioned in Sarva Dosh Nashan Adhyay. It has got fibrinolytic activity, lipid peroxidation, and antioxidant property. It is hepatoprotective and smooth muscle relaxant. So this Punanavadi Kshir Basti also can be used. It is mentioned in Siddhistan, and we can use it in a treatment of diabetic kidney disease. Then Nevrodhadi Kashaya Basti is the is for the better control of diabetes. It is Tiktapatu Kashaya Ras, Ruksha Tikshna Bhu, Ushna Virya, and basically it is used for the better control of the Prameha, Nevrodhadi Kashaya Basti. So here again I had tried to highlight the use of yoga for the healthy kidneys. So we can go for Padhasthasana, Pravrutta Trikonasana, Naukasana, Setubandhasana, Bhujangasana, Ardha Matsyendrasana, Shalabhasana, Paschimottanasana, Marichasana, and Pravrutta Janushirasana. So these are the few of the yogic practices which can increase the blood flow to the organ by some ways or some way of action, and they can improve the health of a kidney. And then these are the home remedies. We can mix equal quantity of musta, fennel seeds, and cumin and coriander seeds, and boil 1 teaspoon of this powder in glass of water and drink it twice a day. It is called as herbal tea to strengthen your kidneys. Or we can again mixture Punanava, Gokshur, fennel seed, and take 1 tablespoon of this mixture and add 2 to 3 tablespoon, and we can have it a day after meal with warm water. So these are a few of the home ready remedies which are been tried by the people effectively to treat the disease. So I think that's all I wanted to tell you about the diabetic kidney disease. If you all